Finally, only copper is left. The copper itself, now called blister copper, is poured from the converter. It is transferred to an anode furnace where it is further refined. In the anode furnace, the blister copper is again subjected to the forced injection of air to eliminate the remaining impurities. The oxygen that remains, however, must now be removed. This is accomplished by a process known as poling, an old method for which science has found no improvements. The green wood of the poles carbonizes, and the oxygen, combining with the carbon, is liberated as a gas. After a sufficient time, determined by tests, the copper is poured to the casting wheel for the formation of copper plates called anodes. The casting wheel consists of molds made of copper covered with a silica sand wash to prevent sticking of the anodes in the molds. About 700 pounds of molten copper flow into each mold. The wheel is moved by an automatic timing device which controls the rate of casting. As the wheel turns, water sprays help cool the anodes. The copper, now about 99.5% pure, is ready to be shipped to the electrolytic refinery. In the refining operation, the purity of the copper from the smelter is raised almost to perfection. This is accomplished through an electrolytic process. Some of the refined copper is then sheared to required sizes, while the rest is melted and cast into bars and ingots. This six-acre building houses 1,800 tanks in which the electrolytic process takes place. The anodes from the smelter are suspended in tanks containing a solution of copper sulfate and sulfuric acid called electrolyte. These starting sheets, or cathodes, of pure refined copper are straightened and suspended between the anodes. The anodes and cathodes are carefully spaced at 4-inch intervals to avoid short circuits. At the point where they are held, electrical contact is established. A centralized pumping system circulates warm electrolyte through the system of tanks. As shown by this model tank, the passage of the current causes the anode to dissolve into solution and drives the copper out of solution, depositing it on the cathode. The impurities are not carried across, but settle to the bottom. Built-up cathodes of pure copper are removed from the tanks every 14 days. The completed cathodes are carried to washers, from which they will be sent to the casting department. The impurities, containing some gold and silver, are collected from the bottom of the tanks. They are sent to another plant for recovery of the valuable materials. Some of the cathodes are now sheared to sizes required by the United States Mint and certain foundries. Other cathodes are melted down in preparation for casting into ingots and bars. In preparation for casting, the molten copper is subjected to air blasts forming some cuprous oxide. The molten bath is then covered with a layer of low sulfur coke. This protects the surface of the copper from further oxidation during poling and casting. As in the smelter, green poles are used to carry off excess oxygen. When tests have determined the proper time, the copper is poured into the molds of a casting wheel. Bars for making wire are cast in 135 to 300 pound sizes. The bars, here undergoing inspection, are used in the fabrication of some of the millions of miles of copper wire produced annually in this country. Next to silver, copper is the most efficient conductor of electricity. It is, therefore, the very foundation upon which the nation's electrical industries are built. Copper is the basic metal used in the generators, sending electricity for power, heat, and light to the nation. Millions of miles of wire and cable carrying this power and energy to the far corners of the country are made of copper. Copper wire links the nation's network of telephones, and the intricate mechanisms of this gigantic communication system rely on copper and its alloys. Copper is used in abundance in the manufacture of the nation's radio sets, and it is playing a major role in the making of thousands of parts in our rapidly growing television industry. Great amounts of copper go into the manufacture of millions of electric motors of all shapes and sizes. Motors which in countless ways are bringing comfort, utility, and efficiency into the everyday activities of the American people. Because of its durability and resistance to corrosion, copper is an important product in our building trades for plumbing, roofing, and lighting fixtures. Copper and its alloys are used for the nation's automobile industry, and in the production of the nation's private, commercial, and military aircraft. And copper plays countless roles in the preservation of our national security. As a direct result of the nation's demand for copper, complete communities have grown in what were once barren, isolated areas. Churches, schools, hospitals, business sections, all have been built around one single purpose: to supply copper. Higher education is also encouraged and aided by the copper industry to develop skills and knowledge that will assure even greater future contributions of copper to mankind. Today, through large capital investments in modern, labor-saving methods and machinery, copper is being produced from relatively low-grade ores, which by former manual methods would have been economically prohibitive to process. Copper is being produced in quantities and at prices which encourage mass production of more finished goods. This aids in greater national employment. Thus, our natural resources of copper are being better developed to serve the nation. And so, in their vast constructive enterprise, the people of the copper industry are giving true support to this symbol of American ideals, which appropriately is made of enduring copper.